Balzer and Bray and Harper Audio present Damsel by Elana K. Arnold, performed by Elizabeth Knowelden. For my brother Zach, who loves dragons. 1. The Dragon's Blame. The castle seemed to grow from the cliffs that cupped the shoreline. Its jagged peaked turrets pierced the rain-heavy clouds above. Its windows were gaping mouths and gored-out eyes. Between the slate-grey cliffs and the smoke-grey sky and the churning grey sea and the ghost-grey mist, it was a grey place indeed. It was so thoroughly grey that a traveller who lost his way could be blinded by it, by the overwhelming greyness that permeated everything, erasing vision entirely. Stay too long in this grey world, the legend went, and risk your eyes turning grey too. Risk your skin growing ashen. Risk your hair dulling to iron. Yes. It was a grey world. Sitting upon the broad back of his night-black steed, Prince Emery of Harding scanned the vast grey scene around him. There was the beach, quiet waves lapping upon the shoreline like a kitten at its dish of cream, the tameness and gentle repetition belying the fierceness Emery knew the great sea had hidden within it. There beneath his horse's hooves was a short, pebbled beach, peppered with stones of all shades of grey, from nearly black to nearly white. Emery and his steed, whom he called Reynard, had emerged onto this beach from a dense forest, through which there was no trail. Emery had been obliged to lead his horse much of the way, slashing a path for them with his sword. As Emery had grown closer to the edge of the forest, the trees he encountered grew harder and harder until finally he found that they were no longer made of wood at all, but rather petrified to stone. These trees even Emery's loyal, lethal sword had been powerless against, a fact that ignited a flame of anger in his chest. When he struck it, a tree should fall. That is what trees do. That is what they had always done. Trees. It was their duty. But these last trees would not fall, and when Emery struck them with his sword, an awful clang rang out, and the impact of the blow vibrated up through Emery's sword arm and rattled all of his bones. Not even a dent. Unacceptable. Yet he had been forced to accept it, had been forced to unsaddle Reynard, so the horse was narrow enough to pick a path through the trees that refused to get out of their way. No matter, Emery had told himself, as he flung the saddle back onto Reynard, as he fastened the girth, horse grunting, as he hefted himself into the saddle once again. He walked the horse along the beach, surveying, and Reynard picked a path through the pebbles. Emery would punish the forest on the dragon's flesh. For he knew it was the dragon's blame that the trees had turned to grey stone, just as it was the dragon's blame that this part of the world was misted dark with unspilled rain, and the dragon's blame that the sea was slate grey instead of blue-green. And the dragon's blame that the unblinking eye of the sun was dulled by a cataract of grey. When the dragon was slain, if he managed to slay it, this part of the world would brighten again, and Emery would be the light-bringer as well as king. He hated the dragon. It was that simple, and his hate was pure, like cleansing fire. He breathed in and out his hatred as he sat upon his steed, as his eyes scanned the cliffs in front of him, searching for a way to climb them, though he knew already that there would be no easy path. Who had built this castle into these cliffs? It was a mystery without an answer. Had they built it, or had it been born? Some wizened elders claimed that the castle emerged from the craggy cliffs over millennia, growing a fraction of an inch a year, surfacing so slowly that its progress was imperceptible. Others countered that the castle had not emerged at all, but simply had always been, like the sea, like the cliffs themselves, and to attempt to trace their origin was a fool's mission. No one knew how the castle had come to be, and Emery did not care. He did not care why a sun hung in the sky. It did, and that was enough for him. As long as it warmed his back each day and disappeared each night, Emery had no desire to waste his time examining the whys and wherefores behind its existence. And that was how he felt about the castle and the cliffs, the sea and the sky. The world was made. That was all. This resolved and set aside left Emery with just the question of how best to conquer it. "I'll have to scale it, Reynard," Emery said. The horse grunted, warm clouds puffing out from his enormous nostrils. "You'll have to wait behind," Emery told him, to which Reynard said nothing. That settled, Emery swung himself out of the saddle once again, landing on the shifting pebbles of the beach. They crunched together under his feet, like bones grinding. Reynard would not need to be tied. He was a good horse, and he wouldn't go far. And if Emery did tie him, and then were to die, either falling from the cliff or in the jaws of the dragon he expected to encounter up above, Reynard would die as well. Everything and everyone dies, of course, but dying while tied by the reins to an outcropping of rocks at the base of a cliff seemed like an undignified way to go. And Reynard was not an undignified animal, and Emery was not, he thought, a cruel master. Once again, Emery unhooked the long leather strap of the girth, pulling it from the brass ring at Reynard's side, unwinding it as the horse relaxed his gut. He heaved the saddle down from Reynard's proud, high back, revealing a square patch of sweat-wet fur, which Emery rubbed dry with the saddle blanket. Then he grabbed the crown piece of the bridle from behind Reynard's ears and pulled it forward, the bit clanking against the horse's teeth. Freed, Reynard stretched his neck long and wandered off, snuffling along the pebbled beach in search of the few grey tufts of seagrass. Emery considered himself to be horse-like in all the best ways. One thing he could do was place blinders on his own vision, focusing on the singular task in front of him, and this he did now, preparing himself for the climb. The saddle and its bags were slung across a boulder, and Emery rifled through them with practiced purpose, gathering what he would need: rope, a pickaxe, a leather pouch of fine powdered chalk, leather gloves, a bladder of fresh water, his sword, which was never far from his body. In his pocket was his lucky talisman, a rabbit's foot he'd cut himself from his first kill when he was 7 years old. Then he walked to the base of the cliffs, an almost vertical wall of slate, and placed his hands on its cold, hard surface. He looked up, craning his neck farther and farther back, and for a flash, it seemed that the old legend had come true, as his field of vision filled so completely with grey. So much grey, so all-encompassing, that Emery was blinded by it, and he felt his bowels loosen with fear, and for a second he was a babe again, powerless and falling, with no knowledge of what was up and what was down, drowning in the grey that whirled around him, tumbling and helpless. But then he caught sight of his own hand against the endless grey wall, and he remembered himself. He was not powerless. He was no babe. He was Emery of Harding, and he had a dragon to slay. Emery's hands. The slate was tricky. It was cold, as hard and slick as ice. There were holds, but Emery found that he could not trust his vision to find them. The trick of greyness all around made this into a shadowless world, and the wall looked flat, without dimension. But if he slid his fingers along its surface, he could feel ridges, wrinkles, recesses. That was where he would grab hold, and he would make a ladder of them, an invisible chain of handholds and footholds. And so, Emery began to climb. He had strapped his sword to his back to free his hips and legs, and belted the pouch of chalk at his waist. He had tucked his black pants into his black boots and his black shirt into his pants. He had used a strip of leather to gather his hair back into a rough knot, keeping it from his eyes. He had rolled his sleeves back, in spite of the cold, knowing that he would warm as he climbed. Hand over hand, hold over hold, Emery ascended. Always he had been a skilled climber, as well as a skilled fighter, a skilled rider, a skilled swimmer. Anything he needed his body to do, it did, and well. Part of the trick was to take his mind off the task. In this, as in many things, his body knew better than his head what must happen next, and his mind's job was to keep still and let the muscles get on with it. As if watching a stranger, Emery saw his fingers creep along the wall, touch and reject a possible hold, find a second hold, accept it, and latch on, claw-like. His feet shimmered up several inches, his biceps curled, and he was higher, 15 feet off the ground at least, and hundreds more to go. To keep his mind entertained while his body was working, Prince Emery of Harding allowed himself to imagine what they might be saying about him back at home. His mother, as ever, came first into his head. He saw her sitting where she liked it best all the year round, regardless of the temperature outside, next to the fireplace in her chambers, pressed up closer to the flames than anyone else could stand, surrounded by cushions and cats, never dogs. "Now, Emery," she was wont to say, patting the cushions beside her, "tell me what you've conquered today." And as a young boy, Emery would obligingly scramble up beside her, even when the heat from the fire made him sweat, and report exactly what he had mastered. The puppy he had trained to follow him through the palace grounds simply by keeping a fatty piece of breakfast meat in his pocket. The teacher he had talked into freeing him from lessons a quarter hour early. The horse he had broken to saddle. The cook he had cajoled into baking an extra cake just for him. Later, when he was too big to cuddle, Emery would stand across from Mother and report, just as proudly, the buck he'd felled in Moss Forest, the soldiers he'd rallied to fight, the rider he'd beaten at joust, the scholar he'd bested at chess. Other conquests, those of the soft skin variety, Emery did not tell Mother about, though he suspected that she both knew and approved of them. Pink-cheeked Elaine, the cowherd's daughter, raven-dark Lila, who kept shop for her mother, the apothecary, flour-dusted kitchen apprentice Fabiana on the heavy canvas sacks of flour in the cool, dark pantry, while old Cookie pretended she didn't know what was going on. And Mother always listened and nodded and approved of the things Emery said and the things he did not say in equal measure. The fire blazed, the cats purred, and Mother listened. Emery's muscles warmed and loosened as he climbed. When his fingers began to slip with sweat on the slate, he dipped them into the bag of chalk, its fine powdery residue recalling the flour that had puffed up from the sacks on which they lay, from Fabiana herself, as they rotted in the pantry back at home. But this was not a safe direction to allow his thoughts to wander. Not now, not here on this cliff, 100 feet above the ground, From here, a fall would be death. So Emery took Fabiana and placed her to the side, out of the way, where she belonged. He watched his left hand reach, fingertips stretched, feeling for a hold that must.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.